morning, everyone. Thank you for coming to class.
Good morning.
It won't be a problem because I'm going to stand over here most of the time.
You don't walk them down.
I kind of do that sometimes because this happens to be one of my favorite topics, and so I do get a little excited. And last hour I even got a little emotional, so you'll have to crack jokes or something. But I wanted to welcome all of you. I'm Louise Evenson. I'm a member here, and I'm also on the board of Lutheran World Relief. I serve with 14 other board members on the national board and find it a real opportunity and an incredible privilege to be involved with LWR. And I have known about LWR ever since I was a little tot, because my parents were involved with LWR. I remember it just rolling off my mother's tongue. LWR, we got to make this for LWR, you know. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about that history. But when I grew up and became an adult, and still working on that, that's in process, then I met the Wenesses. And the Wenesses opened a whole new door for me of understanding of Lutheran World Relief. And so I have to acknowledge them and their work that they have done with Lutheran World Relief for decades also, and what a difference they have made in the life of Lutheran World Relief and the people that we serve. So, on your chairs, there's a response card, and I promise if you don't put your address on there, you're not going to get on any mailing list or anything like that. And you don't have to bring out your checkbooks right now. Later would be fine. on the back of the card, Steve, welcome.
Well, I just went, did you meet these two?
I haven't. Introduce us to your friends.
Pastors Judy and Jim Bankson. How many years were you in Tanzania?
22.
22 years, ELCA missionaries in Tanzania.
Welcome.
And back and forth. And after that, we're in San Jose parishes, or one parish.
One parish
up there. And but I thought there might be some Tanzania stories from them.
Oh, no.
Thank you.
But I wanted Jim and Judy. Thank you.
Thank you,
Steve. Welcome. All of you, welcome. So on the back is space. I'm going to refer to different things during my talk. If you have a question, you know, you can note it there so we can respond to it during the Q&A time. But also there will be some materials that I'll talk about, or some brochures that might be of interest to you. If you want one, let me know. And if I have extras here, I'd love to have you take them. But I need to send them to you because some things I only have a copy of, just note it on the back and I'll make sure that you receive that. So when you hear the words Lutheran World Relief, what comes to your mind? Well, don't be shy. I got a big job I got to be today.
Fair trade for me.
Fair trade for Marsha, for sure.
Quilts.
Quilts.
There you go,
Chase. Good answers. Anything else?
School bags.
School kits. Yes. Thank you, Mary.
Disaster relief.
International disaster relief. Well, I'm going to talk a lot.
Long-term involvement.
Long-term involvement. In 2020, we'll be 75 years old. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about how we got started way back when, and also tell you what we're doing now, why we do that, sometimes how we do it, and then also your role that you could participate with Lutheran World Relief. First of all, I have to tell you that all the pictures I show you are of people that we are either in our programs, they're participants, or country directors or whoever, they're all involved with LWR in some way. We haven't photoshopped them or used stock things. This is a real woman. She's in Kenya, and she's one of the recipients of new farming techniques. She has a family with a couple of sons and a husband, and LWR has taught her better ways to farm so they have more to eat and more to sell in their product. Her particular project that she's been involved in has been funded by the LCMS, Lutheran Church Missouri Synod Mega Churches in America. Why does LWR do this? Well, I think it's just so coincidental and wonderful that this was the scripture that was read today. So let's read it together.
We love because God first loved us. The commandment we have for God is this. Tell us the love of God, and us love of your brothers and sisters also.
And that's our labor of love, Lutheran World Relief. We work in extreme poverty area in very isolated communities, trying to alleviate hunger and malnutrition among the people that we work with. This particular woman lives in Nepal, and as you know, 3 years ago, Nepal experienced a 7.8 magnitude earthquake. And LWR has had staff in Nepal now for nearly 10 years. One of the advantages of that is that when there is a disaster, a humanitarian disaster, this killed about 9,000 people, destroyed 600,000 homes. We have staff there, fortunately, none of them were injured, killed, or lost their homes, but we have staff in Nepal that knows the government, knows other non-governmental organizations like LWR is, and knows where the greatest need is. And we also have projects going on in Nepal, agricultural projects, and so we knew about people that really were at the end of the road and needed our help. So we provided this woman with immediate aid. She needed some food, so we had we have a warehouse. You probably know about the warehouses in the United States, in Minneapolis and Baltimore, because our quilts and kits are shipped to those two places. But we also have a warehouse in Dubai, because we believe that the quilts and kits, hygiene kits and nutrition kits, need to be closer to where disasters happen in the places that we work. And so within days after that earthquake happened, we had a plane filled with quilts, kits, water filtration units, and what else? Oh, temporary shelters. And as soon as the Nepal government allowed us to land, we had immediate need to help this woman and others recover from this terrible disaster. We also continued, not just in the few months after the disaster, but we continued beyond that and helped in restoring her livelihood and helped her learn how to grow potatoes more effectively with some methods that we use with farmers around the world. So how did LWR get started? 1945, huge displacement after World War II in Europe, and Lutherans in the Midwest said, we've got to help them. We have to send them quilts. We have to send them clothes. We have to get them some food. There are children. Winter is coming and children will be hungry. So, look what they did. They sent 44,000 pounds of lard from those farmers in Iowa. And there's a quilt that looks very reminiscent of a quilt my grandmother had on the guest room bed when I was a kid. And there are some German children having, and the blackboard behind, it's hard to read, but it says dried eggs. I don't know how they did that, but they're eating something that was donated. And then here's a whole railroad car that was filled with clothing bags. Although we don't collect clothing anymore, at that time they were. Winter was coming. I have a high school friend, Lonnie, who told me the story about her father, a farmer in South Dakota, who had an extra coat. And he said, I'm going to send my coat on that drive that their church had for LWR. And he put his name and address and phone number in that coat. Mm. And years later, the recipient of that coat called him and thanked him for that. See what I mean? I get a little emotional about that. But we started in response to a humanitarian disaster after World War II. And quite honestly, the Lutherans that started this kind of thought, it's going to be short term. You know, we'll wrap this up in a few years and they'll be back to some normalcy in Europe and they'll be fine. But guess what? There continues to be disasters. And so we moved into being the international humanitarian response arm for the Lutheran Church into more long-term projects. And long-term means 3 to 5 years or longer in some places. Well, this is what displaced people look like today. They don't look like those little German kids. This family is a Syrian family that lives in a tented settlement outside of Syria in Lebanon. and LWR has provided them with quilts, hygiene kits, and school kits, and other things. These displaced people have the same needs that the people needed in 1945. And now is the largest population of displaced and migrating people since World War II that is happening right now. And what is LWR doing? If you're on our mailing list, you might have seen our 2016 annual report. Well, it reports about what we're doing in Syria. You know how bread is the staff of life. We hear about bread in every single culture or some kind of thing. Well, Syria has pita bread, unleavened bread. Their bakeries had been bombed out in this community. And we provided portable ovens so that the people in this community could bake bread. And do they bake bread? They bake 9 tons every day, and they feed 80,000 people. If you want to receive annual reports, jot that on your card, and we'll see that you do. I have some of that, those reports up here that you're welcome to pick up today. We also are the only humanitarian organization, NGO, in West Mosul, Iraq right now, providing support for families. So we have stayed true to dealing with people who are displaced and people who are in great need during crises, conflicts, such as wars and civil wars especially. So this woman experienced the Philippines, the typhoon, Haiyan, in 2013. And so we moved from 1945, and now we're having these droughts that are going on for years. We're having tsunamis, we're having typhoons, we're having earthquakes. That's going to continue. And Lutheran World Relief realizes that it isn't just immediately after recovery. It's for a longer term. You have to get families stabilized. You have to restore their livelihood. And you have to help them become resilient communities. So when the next earthquake happens, when the next typhoon happens, they as a community are better able to cope. So it's not only recovery and adjusting, but it's also preparing. This woman lost her home. She lost her livelihood. And within days, because the staff of Lutheran World Relief has been in the Philippines working for decades on various projects, within days we gave her hope. We gave her temporary shelter. And we know what kind of temporary shelter works in the Philippines that may be different in other parts of the country or the world. We gave her a new means of livelihood. She's raising fish right now. And a new latrine, and eventually built a new home. And so the emergency response has also been a part of this in the recovery to teach her community, how do you respond after a typhoon hits, and how do we set up emergency plans, just like we have here for an earthquake response. We're helping those communities establish that network also. So the Nepal earthquake, again, happened in 2015. Within 1 month, LWR, I should go back just a second. After the typhoon in the Philippines, at that time, we received about, I think it was an $800,000 grant from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And they said, we have heard what you do during times of humanitarian disasters. So we're at the table, and we're going to help you get started in that recovery program. Because when you have a foundation like that, that will have money in your account very quickly, you can send that airplane of supplies. You can respond to their immediate needs much more quickly. And so within 4 months after that typhoon, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation representatives were on the ground seeing what had happened to that money and visiting the various communities that had received the supplies. Now, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation has told us and has funded other disasters, saying, we're there because we trust what you have done. So, a month after this happened in Nepal, LWR had a plan. And it's because we've faced disasters before with people and we know what their needs are. this multi-stage plan, all reliant on donations, was put in place so that we could address immediate needs and then their early recovery needs. The early needs, the immediate needs are 4 months usually. And like I said, it's temporary housing, it's cash for work is another thing that we do. And that helps them clean up their communities, get the debris off the road so that trucks can come in and that sort of thing to restore their community. And they actually get training on how to do that and the proper equipment and clothing for doing that. And then they get money so that they can go and purchase the things that they also need. But that usually takes about 4 months for immediate needs. Then 8 months is the early recovery when their houses might be started to get rebuilt and their livelihoods might be able to be restored.
Jackson.
And then is the community rehabilitation process. So we put together the plan, but then in the annual report the next year, it says 2015 annual report that came out in the fall of 16,
oh, thank you.
We did an update. This is what we're doing with your donation dollars in Nepal. The stats about how many were killed, how many lives were lost, the 100 water filtration units that LWR had on the ground, the 20,000 people we helped, the 4,700 households that received quilts and kits and tarpaulins for temporary shelter. So we reported back to you to let you know that when you give to LWR, it's going to go to these people. And then, in the special report that we just came out, I don't know how many of you got this, here's a whole two-page on families in Nepal are better off now than before the earthquake. How can that be? Well, this family now has a couple of goats that came through LWR, and he also has lemon and orange tree saplings. Where they live is quite an orange and lemon tree area, and we help the citrus growers to grow good stock, but we also help them to know how to store their oranges and lemons in a storehouse so that they can sell it when other oranges and lemons aren't available and they get a higher price that way. So we help them get their livelihoods some 2 years, 3 years after the earthquake. This man, we gave him that, it's like a greenhouse tarpaulin thing, and gave him vegetable seeds, and he has a garden now. He was ready to leave Nepal and migrate somewhere else for work, and he said, I don't have to go now. I'm growing enough food for my family, plus I'm able to sell my vegetables for an income. So again, after a disaster, LWR is very conscientious about reporting back to you, so you know that the money that was donated for that disaster goes to the people that need it the most. Staff, I said, have worked there 10 years. It's a real advantage when we have a staff in the country. We know the Nepal government that way. And we also have built relationships with other non-governmental organizations. We vet them. We make sure that they have the skills and expertise that we're looking for and that we need, and that they also have a similar ethos as we do as far as dignity and respect for the people that we're going to help. And so the NGOs were a big part of our humanitarian international response. So I thought you might want to know, how can we do these things? I know you can't read all the numbers. I'll help you. Last year, the fiscal year ended at the end of September, LWR took in $53 million. The green, which is the largest, came from you, came from individuals and congregations, Lutheran individuals and congregations primarily in the United States. That made up 44%. This has been very consistent through the years, and it's the foundation on which LWR is built to receive other grants from foundations and from the U.S. government with this kind of support and base. The kind of red-orange part is material resources. That's quilts and kits. And you say, well, but, come on, quilts and kits? How do you count that? The IRS tells us the valuation of all contributed quilts and kits. They say that quilt is worth this much and that kit is worth this much. And last year, 26% of our income came from donated goods of quilts and kits. So 70% is coming from congregations and individuals in the United States. The purple part is the U.S. government. We have a very good relationship with the United States Department of Agriculture and the United States AID for international development. You might have heard General Mattis, yeah, him, Secretary of Defense, talk about the three Ds. We need defense, we need diplomacy, we need development. So in the U.S. government, some of our tax dollars go to USAID in the developing world. And LWR has been a recipient of some very nice grants from USAID. The little blue one up there next to the purple is from private foundations. That's like Margaret Cargill Foundation, Osprey Foundation, Bill Gates, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and Starbucks Foundation. So you might be asking, well, what about Ascension? You know, what have we done here for LWR? Well, in addition to the quilts and kits, which you're going to hear more about, through the years, about the last 20 years, LWR has donated about $200,000 in gifts to our work in humanitarian disaster response, to shipping funds for the quilts and kits, and also other designated gifts. I think Gifts of Hope a couple of times went towards some projects of LWR in the past. If you want an annual report, and again, you can take one up here because I have several, you can find out about our expenses and our revenue, but you can also find out what we spend our money on. 85% or 85 cents on every dollar goes toward our programs. And we have about 100 programs going on all the time in the world. 62% of them last year were agricultural programs, and about 30% were humanitarian disaster response. And then we also are dealing with our agricultural participants in the way that climate is changing. So we have several projects that deal with climate change. But 85% of our revenue goes toward projects that we are working on. So again, Ascension. In the last 2 years, we've assembled 1,000 school kits. And those school kits have gone to Honduras and Peru, Angola, Djibouti. And there's a huge need for school kits. In those refugee camps that we are serving in Iraq and in Lebanon and in Jordan, school kits are really appreciated. So the kids have some sense of normalcy when they go to school, when their life is so disrupted. And but we're not going to do tangible school kits this year because of the sanctuary refurbishment, but we're going to try to come up with some other ways that we can support this important ministry. In the past 25 years, 3.3 million school kits have been distributed around the world through LWR. We also do baby kits, and 1.5 million baby kits have been assembled and distributed, and about 3 million hygiene, personal hygiene kits have been shipped all around the world. It costs $1.40 to ship a kit from Camarillo to be picked up in the truck to our warehouse in Minneapolis to be flown to wherever it needs to be distributed. Here's another picture.
Louise, can I just say one thing there? We were visited a warehouse in Tanzania, and there are forms there that organizations, other nonprofits that are going to help distribute things, they have to actually put down where they're going to go. So they keep track of all of those items so that they don't hit the black market. So there are forms that they have to fill out, and they have to make sure that the organizations that are going to distribute them in a certain area, that they go directly to where they're supposed to go.
Thank you, Mary. And then you might recognize the star of our quilting program here, Jan Porter. Jan is in the back row.
Who could not do this with at least 30 people there?
Think about that. At Ascension Lutheran, 30 people help in different ways, putting together thread and material and love, and send about 100 quilts a year to LWR. And you remember the beautiful sanctuary in September that have all the pews covered with these beautiful quilts. And I'm going to pause right now and applaud. Jack Koenig is here. Jack, we have a front row seat here. It's the only one left.
I'm going to sit next to Marty.
Oh, okay, there's one back.
If Jeff will let me.
Come right in.
We're so glad you're back, Jack.
Thank you. Nice to be back. Thank you for all your prayers.
So, over the last 25 years, 8.8 million quilts have been distributed around the world during times of emergencies. And it costs $2.25 to ship a quilt from Camarillo to Minneapolis to wherever. You might say, quilts? Really? You're kidding me. Well, quilts are like a hug. They say to a child, they say to a family, you're not alone. So between the fabric and the thread, we're sending love overseas. You should know that all refugees and displaced people that are in camps receive a UN blanket. It's a typical blue blanket. Everybody gets them. Not everybody gets a quilt made with this kind of love. And the quilt is used for warmth. It's used as a tent, as a floor covering, and sometimes strapping a baby on the back of a mother. So it's very versatile. And if you want to know more about that, I do have a brochure called Servant of All, A Year of Kits with LWR, and it describes all of the different kits, what has to be in a kit, and what you do and everything. So if you're interested in picking that up, you're welcome to that. Or put it on your card, and I'll see that you get another copy. So then you say, okay, you've got money, you've got a mission, you've got goals. Where do you work? Where do you do this? LWR is on 3 continents in 32 different countries. We have over 100 projects going on around the country with 96 different partners and NGOs that bring the expertise to us. And last year we served over 3.4 million people in these different projects. So now I'm going to transition to the other part of LWR, the one that you might not be as familiar with. You are very familiar, I think, with the Quilts and Kits Ministry. I think you're very familiar with the Disaster Relief Ministry that we have, International Disaster Response. But we also work with families in agriculture. And why do you think LWR does that? Why is it a good idea to help people with on farms?
Teach them to catch the fish on their own and grow them.
Exactly. Sustaining. Excellent. Why else? Well, 40% of the global population are small farmers. And this is their largest source of income and jobs, is their farm. Now, we work with small farmers, and I don't mean short. I mean ones that don't, although some of them are pretty short. I mean small farmers in the terms that they might have 1 to 2 hectares of land. That's about 5 acres. That's sustenance. That's usually all for them. And they don't have any money left over for selling. Smallholder farmers usually have about 10 acres or more. And they usually have enough money and income so they not only have food for themselves, but they are able to sell it so they have an income that can send their kids to school, that can provide shelter, going to health clinics and that sort of thing. This is in Northeast India, and LWR had a project there. Peppers have a big market in India.
Yeah.
And if you have the right pepper variety, if you have the right seeds for the climate, And if you have irrigation, you can have a thriving pepper garden, just like we have at our house. But that also means that the men don't have to migrate away from their community. They are able to produce enough so that they can stay in their own communities. This person it has access to one of the irrigation systems we built in Kenya, in a very arid area of Kenya, and he's digging channels for the crops that he is growing. This is how we are investing in people. For nearly 75 years, we've been building these bridges between what we support here into the developing world, developing those partnerships so that people have ways to support their families. This one I'm so excited about. This is in Guatemala. This is a cacao tree. Cacao, C-A-C-A-O. Cacao trees have a fruit that is about this big. And when you pick those cacao fruit and they split them open, guess what's inside?
Chocolate.
Cacao beans, and guess what they make?
Chocolate.
Okay, so in this particular area, how we are helping these young people is that we are helping them in skill development. This particular tree on this farm is not a very productive tree. Therefore, it's taking space, and it's not producing enough money in when they sell the cacao beans and that sort of thing. So these young people go to high school in the afternoon, but in the morning they're learning how to graft a strong branch onto a weak tree so that, the ultimate goal is for that tree then to produce better quality and more cacao fruits. The important thing about training young people in our coffee and cocoa business is the average age of the small farmer for coffee is 60. And young people are not staying on the farm, the coffee farm or the cocoa farm. And so giving these young people a skill means that that's transferable and they can help their community become more income producing, so it might engage them and encourage them to stay in their community. So that's the other thing, is we're teaching young people the skills that make sense for their community. These beautiful women are in Bihar. Part of our emphasis in our agricultural projects that last from 3 to 5 years typically is that when we're gone, what happens? What happens in a community? Okay, you've helped us with this, and we're reliant on you? No. We've got hundreds of other communities we need to go to. So we say we have to build in self-sufficiency. We have to build in resilience in a group. This woman in the center is the leader of a self-help group. And she has been taught better ways to farm. And her group has been taught better ways to farm in their area, planting more varieties, more vegetables, and also developing a safety net, a group savings account, so they don't have to rely on predatory lenders for what their needs might be to enhance their community. When our president CEO met with these women, he asked them, "What more do you need?" And they talked among themselves and they said, "You know, there's another community over here that could really benefit from what you have done with us. So we're okay now. We're self-sustaining." They didn't use that word, but we can sustain what you've taught us. Go and teach somebody else. So that excited. This particular project in Bihar was funded by large ELCA congregations that gave us the funds to work in that part of Bihar. So 80% of the world's coffee is grown by 25 million smallholder farmers. Coffee drinkers, think about that. They have 10 acres of land, or slightly more, is grown by 80% of the coffee are grown by these people. We invest in agriculture. We've had decades of experience at LWR at best practices, how to leverage what we've learned in Latin America to take to Uganda, to take to the Philippines. So we leverage our knowledge, and then we help people farm better. That's the bottom line for this part of LWR. So what do? We give them new techniques, we give them new tools. Hopefully they'll result in better product and higher prices for their family. Godfrey, who's on the cover, he's the cover family on our annual report, and you can read more about him in here. He inherited his farm from his father, and he has four children, and they were hardly making it because the coffee plants were not thriving. So what did we do? We came in and we said, and remember the scripture today, you have to prune these coffee trees. And that will make what is left more intense and of higher quality. It won't drain the plant. And so pruning was a big part of the technique. The trees were already there. I asked about that in Colombia, because I'd heard about the pruning things that they were suggesting in these on these coffee tree farms. And I said, is it like what we do in California in the grape vineyards, where they go through and they take off a quarter to a third of all the things on the grapevines, and the fruit just drops to the land? And they said, exactly. What's left is a better, more intense flavor and better quality coffee beans when they do that. We also taught Godfrey and his family and other coffee growers about only picking those cherry red ripe coffee beans. Sometimes they were just so excited about picking their coffee that they got some ones that were green, and that affects the flavor. And so only pick the red cherry beans. And then post-harvest, coffee is a really messy thing. It takes a lot of water, it takes pulping, getting the shell off the coffee bean, and it drying, and all of this sort of thing. And so we taught them the best way to pulp them using the least amount of water. We taught them organic farming. We taught them about drying the coffee beans so that they, again, have a lower moisture content and then get a higher price when they take them to market. So those were some of the new techniques that we taught Godfrey. Well, this one is a very exciting thing. In February, I was in Bogota, Colombia, with the rest of the board and the senior leadership team. And the next day, we flew in one night. The next day, we were in Land Rovers going on a 5-hour trip in the Andes on very remote areas on very bumpy roads. And imagine, we had a couple of stops along the line, and we're in the middle of nowhere. We are surrounded, and you'll see some pictures, surrounded by these gorgeous Andean mountains, thick, thick vegetation, seeing some terracing on some of the mountains of the coffee trees. And Land Rover stops, says, okay, now you're going for a hike. And we split into three groups and went on different hikes to meet different farmers. And this was the farmer I got to meet. Just imagine that, 5 hours or more out of Bogota, the end of the road, and you see a huge sign with Lutheran World Relief on it. That was pretty exciting. Senor Ramos is the farmer that we met. He's on the left. And this is Emilio. He's our country director. LWR, in almost all situations when we're in those various countries across the developing world, we find somebody who has expertise and can be our country director who is from there. We don't take our people from here and put them there. We find people who know the language and the culture and know agriculture, know NGOs, know what we need, and make them our country director. And Emilio has an amazing resume. Well, they're standing next to something that was funded by a grant from Starbucks Foundation. And it works so well in the Andes and in other places. It's called a garrucha. Garrucha. Let me roll my R's better. And it's spelled right up there, G-A-R-R-U-C-H-A. And it's a cable system that runs up to Senor Ramos's farm, 2,600 feet up the hill. And then it goes even beyond his farm, up more, so that they can, at the top, there are like buckets stores, I've seen shelves that they can put the heavy coffee beans bags on and then take them down to the road at the bottom of the Gorucha. So when the truck comes into their community to take all of their community-raised coffee beans, they have a way to get it from the top of the mountain down. I don't want to even think about what carried those coffee sacks, heavy coffee sacks, before, because they are very, very, very heavy. So this is Emilio talking to another board member and me about the diversification that Senior Ramos's farm has. You can see the banana plants. He also grows sorghum. One of the things that happens with coffee growers is that the season for harvest is April, May, November, December. Now, if you only had income after April, May, November, December, you'd have some pretty lean times. And this is very hard for coffee farmers. So one of the things that we are doing with many coffee farmers around the world is we're helping them plant other cash crops so that they have other harvest times. They shade the coffee trees, and they give them more income at other times of the season. So that was kind of exciting. And you might notice that little, what shall we say, rocky path that's about 18 inches wide. Yeah, we hiked up that path. This is Senior Ramos and our area director, Emilio, next to his compost. Because all the coffee growers that we're working with now, we are teaching how to use the pulping process to grow organically, composting them, and other things like from the banana trees and other things. Starbucks works with these farmers and buys their farmers because of the quality. They wanted these people also to have better hygiene. If you have healthy farmers and families, you have better coffee. And there is no health clinic around the corner for these people. So we taught farmers in this area the wash process, water, sanitation, hygiene. And we updated the latrines. We put in running water and toilets and showers in some of the places because they could have the septic lines and tanks in that area. I think it was leach lines, not tanks. And then just how to stay more healthier by washing your hands. We also talked to them about the importance of, this is a water tank. This big Aqua Viva tank will live longer than us. We provided those kinds of tanks for them so that they can capture the water because, like I said, in the processing and the pulping, a lot of water is used. But then we also taught them, you just don't let that water run down the mountain because it pollutes the streams. And so the watershed and the streams and caring for creation was very important to Starbucks also for the future. And then another part of the program was training a leader to go out and teach others in the community about these various things. And Senior Ramos was one of those experts, local experts, coffee growers, that that will continue to go out and teach, like picking those red cherry cherries and thinning their trees, and then about how to dry them. We help them build these high tables that have like a screen on them, and they put the beans on there, and they have like a hole, and they keep moving the coffee beans so they dry that way. And like I said, they get a better price when it goes to market if they have a certain moisture content. Exciting, while we were in Columbia, Starbucks contacted them, our leadership team, and said, we are so happy with what you've done. This is the final progress report from that project that we read before we visited. This particular project tells all what did we learn, the best practices, who did we help, how many did we help, what did they learn, what didn't work, because we want to know what doesn't work so we can improve the next time. It's all in here. Starbucks loved it, we loved it, and they said, we want to do another project with you. So I just heard from our Latin American director just this week that this next one will be on women's empowerment and water sanitation, because a quarter of the family farmers in Colombia are women. And they are going to be in the FARC area, a rebel-held area at one time. Now they're in a peace process. The government and the rebels have fought for 50 years in Colombia. So the amount of poverty in the outlying areas is unbelievable. They haven't had the infrastructure. They've been fighting wars. But these women farm coffee in the FARC region, and it's safe now. And we're going to teach them water, sanitation, and then also how to be women leaders. So the next time you have some coffee, you know, just think about how far those beans have come for you to enjoy that cup of coffee. And those who were coffee drinkers enjoyed a latte at this other place we visited in the Andes. That it's a 20-acre farm that is owned by an entrepreneur, a Colombian entrepreneur. And he's come to LWR and says, told us, there are 100 little farmers around here, and they don't have enough income. We drove by those farms. They don't have anything. And so they said, he said, flowers grow wonderfully here, and we provide wonderful shade for the coffee bean plants. And cut flowers from Colombia, we all know about that. So will you help us so that these farmers can grow flowers and also can we have beehives so that they can produce honey? So they would have three cash crops, and they wouldn't be just getting it during the harvest time. So that was a pretty exciting thing. So let me just summarize for a minute. Told you about how we started in 1945 in a response after World War II to a huge humanitarian displacement. Our mission has remained consistent. We want to end poverty, we want to deal with injustices, and we want to eliminate human suffering. We are an international emergency response organization, and we address world hunger in these remote communities through agriculture and working with small family farmers. We're teaching them how to farm better. So, what can you do? One of the things you can do is to pick up a special report. You can go online and subscribe. They come out quarterly. You can be informed about the kinds of projects that we are working on. This one is tremendously exciting. It's in Burkina Faso in Western Africa. And you probably hear about that in the news as a conflict zone. Fortunately, where our farmers are, they are not in that conflict area. But our VP for International Programs says that's the place that keeps him awake at night. We are working, this is a big grant, it's with the United States Department of Agriculture. It'll go over 5 years. The value is $20 million. So they really have entrusted LWR to be able to deliver. 90,000 sesame seed farmers are going to be able to grow sesame and sell sesame seeds and sesame oil on the world market. And LWR is facilitating that project through USDA. That's the kind of information you find to be informed about what LWR does if you have an annual, a quarterly report like that. Another thing that you would, I encourage you to do, Pastor Steve is taking a group to Peru. This congregation has taken groups there 5 times now. This will be the 5th time. Steve's been there 10 times. They have different places that they work at and orphanages and that sort of thing in Peru. LWR has been in Peru since 1979. So we have an office in Lima. Paul and I went there in 2014 and saw a couple of our farming projects there. And so you can be informed about what LWR is doing in Peru. So you can link in with Steve. I think they're going to meet with our staff there. When this group is there. So learn more about what LWR is doing. The second thing is you can give a financial gift. You can do that through LWR gifts. We have a catalog, and it's all based on farming. It's water, it's chicks, it's goats, it's saplings, it's quilts and kits. So this is a very suitable thing for people that have a passion to give this kind of alternative gift. And this catalog is available, and you can shop it online and buy it online. Another thing you can do is when you donate money individually, you saw that 44% of our income every year comes from individuals and congregations. The majority is from individuals. This was what some of those gifts funded. I know that this congregation has been involved in South Sudan. This is what we're, LWR is doing in South Sudan, serving a community of 290,000 people who have fled the civil war that's going on there. And we're providing nutrition for children 1 to 5 years old and for nursing mothers to get them healthy. Here they're being measured for how malnourished they are. This is the kind of work that we're doing in South Sudan. So that's the kind of other thing that is supported by gifts, when we can go into those conflict zones and into the other very impoverished areas to bring nutrition and health to people. You can make a quilt or kit. Now, not everybody likes to sew. I'm allergic to thread and needles, I think. But there are plenty of people here, 30 of them, right, that do certain pieces of quilts. And school kits, and hygiene kits, and baby kits. Now, we're not going to do that this year, but some of you have big families, or extended families, or involved in another organization, and they are looking for a project. You can take this booklet and take it to your family or to your group that you're involved in. Let's do this. Let's do school kits this year. Let's do baby kits this year. And so you can do that as a family project or a group project of that kind. We receive them wherever they come from. Just follow the guidelines, because they don't take pointy scissors. And you need to follow their directions. So you can participate in quilts and kits. You can also buy LWR Farmers Market coffee. And at this point, I want, if you put your name on a card, or even if you haven't yet, you still have a moment, I'm going to give you some coffee from Farmers Market Coffee. And so just pass that around and put your card in, and we'll have a drawing during our Q&A time. So for over 25 years, LWR actually started Equal Exchange. And last year, we decided that we wanted to have our own coffee grown by our own farmers, so that our farmers will get even more money from their coffee, plus there will be some left over for their community when we sell our coffee. And so we came out with this Farmers Market coffee, and if you want to know more about the process of how we got it started, here's a little brochure for you. And I know Marcia has that on Fair Trade Sundays or weekends.
Next weekend.
So that's another way that you can support LWR, is buying their coffee. Well, this is what we saw when we got up to the top of Senor Ramos's farm in outside of in Colombia, in the Andes. This was the day before Ash Wednesday. So, what kind of questions
here,
do you have?
All the cards are in there. You can go ahead with the drawing.
Thanks.
Yes.
I was just curious, being basically a Christian organization, did you have any grief getting into Muslim countries, Hindu countries? Or do you have the knowledge that they don't have? You know, you don't hear about Muslims going out and helping their own, let's face it.
No, they do.
But you'd hear more about Christian organizations, it seems.
Well,
like,
first of all, we do not put on any quilt or kit any identification that it comes from a Christian organization.
Oh.
And the reason why is that many of the people that receive our quilts and kits are not Christian.
Right, yeah. That's
they
right.
are Muslim.
Yeah.
They could be Hindu. They
yeah.
could be Buddhist.
Yeah.
And we don't want to have a shipment stopped at a port and not allowed in, because these were made by Christians.
Mm-hmm.
And so we do not, there are some organizations that do put their Christian identity on it.
Mm-hmm.
LWR has said we don't want that
yeah.
to be an obstacle for people in an emergency situation to receive a kit or quilt. Good question. What other things?
You say it's involved with hunger. Is there any working together with ELCA, World Hunger, for instance?
Okay, so this is a really good question because we decided. I know, it's kind of over your normal.
Yeah.
You know, he's kind of exceeding expectations with such an in-depth question. So we believe that